Hello and welcome to everyone who's joining us online. Today we're looking at John chapter 7. We're not going to read all of chapter 7, but some verses from that. So if you want to follow in your Bible, we're beginning at John chapter 7, verse 1. It says, after this, Jesus went around in Galilee, purposefully staying away from Judea, because the Jews there were waiting to take his life. But when the Jews' Feast of Tabernacles was near, Jesus' brothers said to him, you ought to leave here and go to Judea, so that your disciples may see the miracles you do. No one who wants to become a public figure acts in secret. Since you are doing these things, show yourself to the world. For even his own brothers did not believe in him. Therefore Jesus said to them, the time for me has not yet come. For you, any time is right. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me, because I testify that what it does is evil. You go to the feast. I am not yet going up to the feast, because for me, the right time has not yet come. Having said this, he stayed in Galilee. However, after his brothers had left for the feast, he went also, not publicly, but in secret. Now, at the feast, the Jews were watching for him and asking, where is that man? Among the crowds that were there were widespread whispering about him. Some said, he is a good man. Others replied, no, he deceives the people. But no one would say anything publicly about him for fear of the Jews. Not until halfway through the feast did Jesus go up to the temple courts and begin to teach. The Jews were amazed and asked, how did this man get such learning without having studied? Jesus answered, my teaching is not my own. It comes from him who sent me. If anyone chooses to do God's will, he will find out whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own. He who speaks on his own does so to gain honour for himself. But he who works for the honour of the one who sent him is a man of truth. And we pick up at verse 25. At that point, some of the people of Jerusalem began to ask, isn't this the man that they are trying to kill? Here he is, speaking publicly, and they are not saying a word to him. Have the authorities really concluded that he is the Christ? But we know where this man is from. When the Christ comes, no one will know where he is from. Then we pick up again at verse 37. On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within him. By this, he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified. Let us pray before we look at this passage together. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the opportunity we have to be able to come together online and to think a little bit more about this passage and what you're saying to us. Father, we ask you to open up our hearts and minds that we would hear you speaking to us. We ask this in your name. Amen. Well, although we're not going to look at the whole of chapter 7, I would urge you at some point to read all of that chapter, because we're not going to be looking at the rest of it in our sermon series. So if you have the time sometime, I'd urge you to read the whole of that chapter to put into context what we're going to be thinking about today. The passage that we're looking at from chapter 7. It takes place during a time of festival, a feast time, and it was one of the most joyous festivals in the Jewish calendar. It's called Sukkot, or the Feast of Tabernacles. And it took place in what is October in our calendar. It's when the harvest had been gathered in. And it was a well-attended festival, because it was, firstly, because it was exciting. It was a great festival. And also, it was one of the three festivals that required the attendance of Jewish males who lived within 20 miles of Jerusalem. It began 5 days after the Day of Atonement and approximately 6 months after Passover. And it lasted for a week. And during that week, during the week of the festival, people made shelters to live in. And living in those shelters reminded them of the time they spent living in shelters in the 40 years that they spent wandering in the desert after the exodus from Egypt. The shelters were decorated with lights and natural materials, and then people lived in them for the festival. It was a time when families celebrated together. It's also a festival that's celebrated now, and you can find pictures of booths that people are living in. If you type into Google Images Sukkot or Feast of Tabernacles, you can see some of the types of shelters that Jewish people use to celebrate this festival now. And it's this festival of tabernacles, that's referred to in the chapter that we're looking at today. Last week we thought about Jesus saying that he was the bread of life. And as a result of that, many people left following him because they weren't interested in a saviour who could meet primarily their spiritual needs. They wanted a Messiah who would meet primarily their physical needs. So at this point, many left him. And we pick up at the beginning of chapter 7. It says in verse 1, "After this, Jesus went around in Galilee, purposefully staying away from Judea, because the Jews there were waiting to take his life. And now the time has come for the Feast of Tabernacles." And it was expected that Jesus would attend this festival in Jerusalem. And his brothers tried to goad him into going to the festival. Verse 3, so they say, "You ought to leave here and go to Judea, so that your disciples there may see the miracles you do. No one who wants to become a public figure acts in secret. So if you're doing these things, show yourself to the world." Well, they were not being sincere, really, in what they said. As verse 5 makes clear that at this point, they don't believe in Jesus. Jesus says that the time isn't right for him. So his brothers go to the festival without him. And then, after remaining where he is, Jesus sets out for Jerusalem after his brothers have left. Travelling in this way, without his brothers or the other disciples with him, he's able to go there in secret. So he's not mobbed by the people on the way, and he can arrive without being recognised. And this will allow him to choose when to speak and reveal himself to the gathered crowds. The Jewish leaders were on the lookout for Jesus. They expected him to go to the festival. They were looking out for him, not because they wanted to hear his teaching, but because they wanted to put him to death. And the crowd are divided. They're divided about whether he's a good man or whether he deceives the people. So you can sense there's quite a tense atmosphere there. The festival's in full swing. People are enjoying themselves, and there's many, many people in Jerusalem. And it's now the halfway point, halfway through the week. It's at this point that Jesus stands up in the temple and begins to teach, when the city will be full of people. Verse 14 says, "Not until halfway through the feast did Jesus go up to the temple courts and begin to teach." The Jews were amazed and asked, "How did this man get such learning without having studied?" Jesus answered, "My teaching is not my own. It comes from him who sent me. If anyone chooses to do God's will, he will find out whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own. Whoever speaks on their own does so to gain honour for himself. But he who seeks the honour of the one who sent him is a man of truth. There is nothing false about him." The people recognized that Jesus' teaching was different, that it wasn't like that of the Pharisees. But they also knew that he'd not studied under any of the recognized important teachers. So they're puzzled as to where his teaching comes from. Jesus makes it clear that his teaching comes from God and asks in verse 17 why they're trying to kill him. The crowd are unaware that this is what the leaders want. And so they respond by saying that Jesus must be demon-possessed or paranoid, basically, because no one's out to kill him. In verse 25 it says, "At that point, some of the people of Jerusalem began to ask, 'Isn't this the man they're trying to kill? Here he is, speaking publicly, and they are not saying a word to him. Have the authorities really concluded that he is the Christ? But we know where this man is from. When the Christ comes, no one will know where he is from.' Then Jesus, still teaching in the temple courts, cried out, 'Yes, you know me, and you know where I am from. I am not here on my own authority, but he who sent me is true. You do not know him, but I know him, because I am from him, and he sent me.'" There was a popular belief that the Messiah would simply appear. But by thinking this, they were ignoring the scriptures which clearly predicted that the Messiah would have a birthplace. They clearly predicted where the Messiah's birthplace would be. Passages such as Micah 5:2, which says, "But you, Bethlehem, Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times." The murmurings and speculation continue. And then we come to what for me is perhaps the climax of this chapter. In verse 37, it says, "On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, 'If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within them.' By this, he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time, the Spirit had not been given, since Jesus had not yet been glorified." To fully understand the impact of this statement, we need to think a little bit about the context in which it was said and what was happening to that day. As we know, all this was taking place during the Feast of Tabernacles. And we know that the people lived in shelters for this feast. But there was also daily rituals that took place. Every day, the crowds would gather at the temple and they'd come along with an ertog, which is a type of citrus fruit, a bit like a lemon. And this was a reminder of the promised land that they'd been brought to and the bountiful blessings of God. And they would also hold a louver, which is a combination of three branches, of well, branches from three trees, a palm, willow, and myrtle. And these were symbols of the stages of their ancestors' journey through the wilderness. With the crowd gathered and their branches and fruit in their hand and everything ready, the priest would then take a golden pitcher, a jug, and with the crowds following and waving the branches and reciting some of the psalms, they would make their way to the pool of Siloam. There, the priest would dip the pitcher into the water and say words from Isaiah 12:3, which says, "With joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation." Everyone would then head back to the temple, enter to the sound of trumpets, and after circling the altar once, the priest would then climb the steps and pour out the water on the altar as an offering to God. On the last day of the festival, the same thing would happen, but this time the priest would circle the altar seven times. After he came round for the sixth time, he would be joined by another priest carrying wine. They would both ascend the steps to the altar, and the priest would hold the pitcher high in the air and encouraged by the crowds to hold it higher before pouring it out. It was considered to be a great joy and blessing if you could see the water being poured onto the altar. And it's at this moment, this important part of the feast, that Jesus stands and calls out in a loud voice, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink." Jesus chose the right moment. His words were powerful, and the ceremonies taking place made them so much more significant and meaningful to the crowds hearing him. They had a ready-made visual aid. Jesus chose the right time for his words to have impact. "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink." I wonder, do we have a thirst for God? In this country, we have ready access to clean, safe water. And it's very rare that we become so thirsty that all we can think about is satisfying that thirst. We might say that we're thirsty, but I doubt that many of us have been in situations where we're so dehydrated that all we can focus on is having a drink. It was that kind of thirst that Jesus is talking about. A thirst for God that only Jesus can satisfy. To thirst for the water that Christ gives is to thirst for righteousness. Not only does Jesus invite us to drink, not only does he invite the thirsty to drink, but he also says, "Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within them." By this he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. That means that for those of us who surrendered our lives to Jesus, believing that he died in our place and rose again, we have those streams of the living water of the Holy Spirit flowing through us. The Holy Spirit living in us should flow from us to others. The love of Christ should flow out of us. It's not a gift we should be keeping concealed within us. We shouldn't be building an inner dam to stop the living water flowing out of us into a dry and thirsty land. Our love for God should be so great that it's impossible to stop the living water flowing from us and impacting the world around us. So, have we drunk of the living water? And does that living water flow out of us to others? Or have we stemmed the flow? Jesus said, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within them." By this, he meant the Spirit, whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Let us come and drink of the living water. Let us ask God to fill us to overflowing with the Holy Spirit, that streams of living water may flow out of us to bless others and draw them to Jesus, the living water that can truly satisfy those who thirst. Let us bring water to a dry and thirsty world. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for sending Jesus to be our living water. May we drink from the water of life by surrendering our lives to you. Fill us to overflowing with your Holy Spirit, that we might be a blessing to others and draw people to Jesus. Amen.